Secretary Torres, our youth suicide rate continues to be quite high. Is that still true? Have we made any headway?
I think we made a little bit of headway. You know, we in 2008 were third in the nation and now we're seventh. So we still have a lot of work ahead.
One of the things that has come up to address this is a bill that you got passed, Senator Lovejoy. Can you talk about those? This was specifically to deal with Native American.
The whole attempt for a clearinghouse was the fact that when all the suicide numbers arose in these remote areas, it showed that the agencies who came together were really not sharing their data and their information. Everybody was very territorial. And so I think the idea of clearinghouse was to bring about some function that would show some transparency to guide all of the tribes.
A lot of Native communities are relatively remote and isolated. There aren't a lot of services available, and there isn't a lot of technical assistance. Some of you mentioned that there's a number of prevention programs, but they may not have been evaluated or evidence-based. Increasingly, it's more difficult to access funding to implement programs unless they've been evaluated. So the purpose of the Clearinghouse, which we're calling honoringnativelife.org, is to provide technical assistance and support to Native communities to respond in the event of a crisis, to provide support to families and communities in the event that something occurs, and then also to provide pretty robust technical assistance if they wish to write grants or evaluate programs. But they also could call the center and get technical assistance to do, sometimes they need help developing a crisis response team, developing postvention plans. A critical need is handling the media when an event occurs, because if the media is not handled appropriately, that can actually lead to additional incidents and what we call contagion.
This becomes a place where those linkages can take place in a supportive way. To whatever degrees tribes would like that support around their decisions about intervening.
Is this a model, Secretary Torres, that could work on a larger framework in the state?
You know, the vision for the Department of Health is to have a healthy state of mind, because I think if people believe they're healthy, they'll be healthy. And part what we need to know is that physical and mental health go together. And what's really key to me in the time that I'm going to be Secretary of Health is to really have a place where there's just one number. People really need to have somewhere where someone talks to them, but then there's intervention and then there's follow through. One of the things that the Native Americans have really focused on is on purpose of life and identity, because what we see in youth is a sense of hopelessness. And once they reach that, I think it's really hard to bring them back. So I think these efforts have made a big difference and something I want to see statewide.
I'm hearing a lot of themes coming out about, you know, working on family dynamics, community interconnectedness. Is there a way we can address these policy-wise? These are very complex issues.
Well, we hope that the clearinghouse, at least for the Native American suicide prevention is concerned, will be able to get into the family.
And is it funded adequately to do?
It's not funded adequately. Nothing is ever funded adequately, I'm afraid, within a state, any government. But we want to look to the clearinghouse as a model that's going to be successful. This was not intended to be just another program. We know, for example, within Indian Health Service, they don't have the adequate trained profession in mental health, and that adds to part of the problem. We hope that this clearinghouse will begin to expand and address those problems that now exist.
I think that one of the things that's maybe coming down the pike and could be really helpful is the integration of physical health and mental health. So one of the things we know about what increases risk of suicidality is a major medical event or trauma. And so those kinds of things, once our systems are talking to each other, and actually providing that level of both accountability and a continuum of care and support in all of those ways, I think it will really benefit.
Where should we focus our resources? Oh, go ahead, Craig.
Schools are the hub. Most all kids are in schools. Most all families are in relation to the schools. Better training in the schools for identifying behavioral health issues, physical health issues. And I think the Albuquerque schools and the Santa Fe schools, and there's others, but they're my point of reference, have really demonstrated through funding that they've gotten through the Safe School Healthy Students Grant that funds need to be sustained and continued. They've had huge success.
Is that a federal grant?
Mm-hmm. And it's had huge success in providing mental health services in the school.
Within our district, we know we heard a lot of our youth telling us our counselors are more involved with schedules, career. They're not there to counsel anymore. So I think a lot of funding needs to go back to where the kids are. And, you know, out of the 8 hours out of the day, they're at school. So, you know, in those programs, I think...
You think you should train the teachers and the counselors?
Yes. You know, actually, Nancy Kirkpatrick from the Department of Health just sent all of us an email. I think Alaska, and was it South Carolina, perhaps, just passed a bill that every 5 years, every teacher has to kind of re-up, as in like a continuing education credit, a suicide prevention training. And, you know, she actually asked me to work on that, and so I'm going
to... Do you have a sense how the teachers would react to that? I just know they have a lot
of their
plate,
and it's for the middle schools and the high schools, and I don't even know if our middle schools and high school teachers have a CEU requirement, which I don't think is the case.
But even in addition to teachers, you know, students are also talking to the bus driver, the janitor, the person who might serve food at the school.
And in
many schools around the country, every single person in that school gets suicide prevention training, because it's not just about the teachers or the school counselors. But, you know, as we've talked about, it can be that one person that touches your life, that makes that connection, needs to know how to then provide that support and say, this is what they talked to me about. I need to get this student linked to some support.
Is that something that, I mean,
yes.
Your department, yes?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Steve is referring to is something that's called gatekeeper training. And the gatekeepers are those people who are there and can see that someone's in trouble. It's a kid you see every day. It's an adult you see every day. In fact, one of the unintended consequences that people have found with natural helpers is the kids start to pick up the teachers that are struggling too, because now they know what to look for.
I think what's happening, though, are the teachers are more comfortable referring and not feeling a stigma to refer to behavioral health. And I think, you know, our janitors, our community, or even our parent committee is accessing the QPR training, and we've seen a rise in our referrals.
What does QPR stand for? That's very common.
Question, persuade, refer.
Okay.
So that's the gatekeeper training that we use at NACA, in addition to natural helpers. And I think for leadership we need more prevention dollars. We got major cuts in prevention these last few years, and so we are trying to do the best we can with what we have. And so we're really hitting our 6th, 7th, and 8th graders hard with life skills and trying to get them acquainted with signs of depression, of alcohol use, cigarette, but also building in the resiliency component, because we always try to make sure there's a cultural competency piece, because we're at the Native American Community Academy, want to make sure we have our cultural core values infused in the curriculum. And we've been doing this for the last 3 years, and it's been pretty good in the sense that the teachers now come to us asking behavioral health and prevention, how can we do this differently? It's a really nice connection and a community that we've built at NACA.
Where do the prevention dollars come from?
Senator Lovejoy mentioned earlier, or you asked, did we get enough funding? And for 2 years now, we've been working on this. So this next year, we'll be advocating for prevention dollars, because the original bill to set up the Clearinghouse also included 3 community-based projects that were funded at $100,000 each. And the hope is that we'll be able to get those funds this year and be able to implement those projects.
When we look at all these prevention dollars, it's not just from the state or the feds, but it's also foundation money, which we're starting to see a lot of different foundations in the state and nationally are beginning to focus on some of these issues. So, and then the community deciding if that's really what is important to them.
How do you take the stigma away?
like doing this show is a beginning, at least, even if it touches one person saying, I really can ask for help or I really can speak out. I think that that person will be able to then say, I could ask for help. I should let others know that I can ask for help. And so it can kind of continue and become a broader like spectrum of people being able to speak out.
When we talk about, we mentioned QPR training, that's one of the goals of that. I'm a QPR trainer and I'm actually a QPR trainer of trainers. We are funded partially through Optum Health New Mexico and partially through the New Mexico Department of Health. And we have almost 60 trainers now across the state. We can provide free training anywhere.
You do that too, to go.
And anybody just has to call us. I know we've trained folks at NACA. Because we want to build that community capacity. And really, QPR can be done in as little as an hour. It's the most basic gatekeeper training that there is. And my goal is always to get people more comfortable with the most uncomfortable topic that they could possibly ever talk
would that
about.
Have, do you think that would have helped in your case, Audrey?
Yeah, I think a big part of getting rid of the stigma is letting people know not only is it okay to talk about this, it's also okay to feel that way. I mean, a really hard thing to go through is being in a position, part of why you don't want to tell anybody about how you're feeling is there's this general unspoken feeling of you shouldn't feel that way. Life is hard for everybody. Not everybody has to make this decision and you can do this. You're not trying hard enough. There's just this feeling of being pressured to keep going, even though you're struggling, you can't keep going anymore. And so you don't want to tell anybody about this. So I think it really helps if, you know, you sit down with somebody and you're like, hey, I'm feeling this way. And they say, that's okay. Who wouldn't in your situation? Who doesn't go through these really hard times?
That's kind of counter to American culture in a way, right? We're saying, go ask for help, go be needy, go be weak, in a sense. And when it's really not the case, going to talk to someone about your deepest, darkest secrets, I'm sure all of you can attest, was probably the strongest thing you ever did. And so we need to start changing that culture. And so through gatekeeper training, we're talking about it so people can be comfortable talking about it. And it's really simple. And that's kind of why I actually like what Alaska and one of the Carolinas, I can't remember which one, did, is it creates a regular and sustained type conversation for people on a, you know, every 5-year basis, that kind of thing. And so we're actually going to make sure that people are talking about it. And it's very simple when you have places like our programs that will train people for free. It's kind of just about making a rule.
If you have a child that's having an asthma attack, to say, sorry, we don't have any providers available to see you, is not an acceptable response in our country at this point. I mean, it may rarely happen, but it's not how our system works. But then to say, all right, we have a child who's suicidal, well, I'm sorry, you know, they can get an appointment in a week, you know, is a different frame. And so I think part of the issue is, you know, as we break down stigma and build the voice, I think that's where parity happens, and parity can even legally be in place, but that doesn't make us build the workforce and necessarily build the system that still needs to get developed.
Really, anybody can be a gatekeeper, and I think that's what New Mexico, you really all try to do, is kids find someone they're comfortable with, and I think that's important to lots of us who are neighbors, who we probably, I swear other kids listen to me better than my own, and every parent knows that. But and sometimes when you're frustrated with your own teen, the reality is you have to remember that they need to have relationships with people that they can have confidential conversations with when they're down, because they're trying to do the best and be the best for their parent. So it's very difficult for kids to have to tell their parents when they're really down, because their parents have such high expectations sometimes. So I think it's great that we just don't focus on teachers, but that everyone at the school plays an important role in those kids' lives.
I was going to ask you, because you started a new nonprofit, and it's a respite house called Waking Up Alive. Yes. And the idea is just to give people a place, if they're in crisis, to just get away.
It's that safe place, this is exactly what Audrey was talking about, where it's within those walls, it is perfectly acceptable to talk about the fact that you're miserable. People say the most insane things to you when you are in that state. I've been told, I need to smile more, and I need to be more positive, and I need to just stop thinking like that. And that's the common response, because no one knows what to do, and they're so terrified of saying the wrong thing. Because this isn't common sense for most people. How are we supposed to know how to deal with some of these things?
So what can we do to support those people out there, given our always limited funding?
Actually, I think what's really important about this discussion is for years, I think a lot of people viewed suicide as something that was sort of unavoidable. Once somebody makes up their mind, there's nothing you can do. And I think what's really powerful about this discussion is it's preventable. And it's a public health crisis. And knowing that it's a preventable, needless tragedy is so huge.
I think one of the things that you see when you do QPR trainings or any other types of trainings that we offer is you kind of see people kind of light up, you know, I can do something, empower them that it is empower them to understand that it is preventable. That's a pretty amazing thing. But the truth is, and from our perspective at a crisis center, you know, there's too many gaps. And right now a crisis center is a difficult thing. Steve and I talk a lot about this, and we say, how can we prove that crisis centers work? And so we need gap fillers, probably something like crisis centers that can help people when they can't find anyone else to talk to. But we need to put some evaluation dollars there. We need some focus on, you know, what can we do for those people that can't get into a bed?
I think what's hard is getting everyone to understand that it's not just certain people's problem. Mm-hmm. I think, like you bring up, everyone has a point in their life when they're really down, but a lot of people have a lot of people around them to bring them up. Mm-hmm. And there, when we have people who reach that point where they think there is no one around, and that's where we see the gaps. Because I think having crisis lines, even though you say, how do we, I mean, some kids just need to talk to somebody, and they need somebody that's not going to Facebook it or Twitter it, but that, and they still need human contact, which the phone line helps, but they really do need to just sit with somebody that mm-hmm. hugs them and say, it's okay, it's not the end of the world.
So how do we do that?
Right.
How do we provide it?
At the same time, you know, we're also in many cases dealing with serious mental health issues. Mm-hmm. And I think we also
so
can't ignore that fact, at least in some situations. So part of it is, you know, we're comfortable doing hearing and vision screening, but you know, we're not in a world where we can do screening for mental health issues in early ages, in elementary schools. We're able to build them into school-based programs, maybe sometimes in middle and high schools. One of the issues is, well, we don't want to screen because what do we do with the results? Mm-hmm. So part of the issue is being able to ask the question and then being able to support our providers and learning what to do with the answers. Mm-hmm. And so part of it continues to be education of primary care, school people, and then being able to develop sort of those linkages.
I think that the paradigm shift about, you know, validation, which is what Audrey was talking about, and what you guys were talking about in terms of that, this is as hard as it gets for me. Okay, let's just pause here, and let's stop, and let's check my anxiety and my fear about being a provider and what to do and having to call LCA and write an incident report. And let's just, you know, hold the space for this kid. And I think that that kind of paradigm shift, both about substance abuse and dependence on mental health issues, you know, really, really needs to happen.
Would it take like regulation or rules saying you have to screen for this in schools, or is it teaching doctors,
you know,
like when you're checking their tonsils, by the way.
It's all the U.S. Preventative Task Force does now recommend screening for depression, you know, from ages 12 through 18.
Okay.
And, you know, they recommend a lot of screenings. But I think this potentially is a really, you know, critical one to be thinking about. And within that framework, providing the support, I think, for family practice and other, you know, and other primary care folks to have the linkages around that and the behavioral health support still
remain.
Can
you do
critical.
That on a state level, or does that require?
Well, you know, it's a hard thing to answer, really, because it's all of the above. You know, it's legislature providing legislation that will provide money for things. Education, whether it's for the providers, educators, or behavioral health providers, it's that. But somebody said earlier, it's everybody's problem. Who said that?
Secretary Torres.
Yeah, and that's well said. It is everybody's problem because this is an issue that goes across every line, whether it's socioeconomic from the lowest income families with the greatest chronic stressors as a result of that, to the highest income families and the kinds of stressors that are different. But kids are as suicidal in the high economics as they are in the low economics. Kids with serious emotional behavioral problems, to kids really without many serious behavioral mental health problems, but in that moment in criticalness, like I mentioned earlier, they're going to be acute and act on it. So it just goes across all those spectrums. It's hard to know what to do. Any social issue we've had over the generations, the more it's talked about, the more it's acceptable to talk about, the more we bring it to the attention of decision makers, of parents to be able to talk about things so it can be talked about and connections can be made. That's how there's always been transformation on any social critical issue.
I appreciate you all coming to talk about this. I know it's a very complicated issue, and especially appreciate you all coming to share your experiences. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jeremy Jaramillo of the Agora Crisis Center. If you're in crisis and need help, please call the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline at 1-800-273-TALK.